Hello, we're live. This is Linda Franz on Facebook for Inklingo, and we're streaming live from Burlington, Ontario, Canada. And this time I am going to try to keep it really simple. It's been quite a week here, and I want to correct some of the mistakes that I feel I made last time. Like looking at the wrong camera. I'm going to tell you right now, I have a little monitor off to my right here where I can see what you should be seeing, and I can see the next thing that I want to share. And it might be this little camera just off here to my left, and there's another camera. It might be that I want to share my screen. And last time, in video number three, I was so concerned with showing the wrong thing that I looked over there quite a lot, and it really bothered me on the replay. I thought, oh my goodness, I was always looking at the wrong camera. So this time, I'm going to try to correct the mistakes from last time by always looking at this little camera when I'm on screen. I wish I could see you because it is kind of odd just talking to a camera. And I can see, oh, I can see if I glance down to my left here that some of you have joined us. Oh, hi, Cindy in Massachusetts. Oh, this is great. I'll be keeping an eye on this all the way through. But it's hard for me to glance to that side too because what is showing on Facebook is maybe, I don't know, 15 or 20 seconds behind what I'm seeing on my monitor. So, what I'd like you to do to give me the benefit of the doubt is imagine just how much people dislike public speaking, and then in person, and then add to that the idea that you can't even see your audience, and multiply it by 65 or more countries all watching at the same time. Some of you who are seeing me for the first time. And it's a wonder I can do this at all. Anyway, I hope you'll be kind if I'm looking over there to check what I'm doing or if I'm looking over there to see what's on Facebook. Russ is lying on the couch in the next room, trying to manipulate an iPad so that he can watch. And I have a kind friend in Cincinnati who is acting as a monitor so that when I think up new mistakes this time, she will be able to alert me. I've already got one little beep from her saying she can see me and she can hear me. So we're off to a good start. Anyway, I do have these different cameras and things set up to show you today. I'm going to just switch now to a wider view and talk a little bit about what's been going on here in Canada this week. It's been cold, but not as brutal as it was the week before. But I was in the shower shampooing my hair on Wednesday when we lost water. And it turned out that our 20 or 30-year-old well pump had blown a capacitor. I'd never heard of such a thing, but we did get water back after about 24 hours. That was one little glitch. Another little glitch was waking up to the doorbell ringing while we were still asleep on Monday morning, and there was a transport truck outside. 2 days early with a delivery of Patchwork of the Crosses. This is the sixth time we've gone through printing this, and it turns out it's a just-in-time delivery. They were delivered on Monday, and on Tuesday, I had a distributor order that I couldn't have filled without the truck delivery. Anyway, that's all great news to get more of one of my favorite books. This is my centerfold if you're not familiar with the book. I've decided that because of the new delivery And because I have actually carried all of the boxes of books into the house, that I have sort of set aside my original plans for this video, and I'm going to talk about Patchwork of the Crosses. And one of the reasons that I wanted to do that, I think it's a perfect thing because after the well, oh, and another delivery this week. I had 100 pizza boxes delivered, and you can see some of them here behind me. I've started to organize all my samples for photography and so that I can find things. So between having the books delivered, trying to organize my stuff in pizza boxes, and having no water for 24 hours, I thought, you know, for the live video on Friday night, maybe I will just try to keep this simple and not try to do quite as much as I did last time. So Patchwork of the Crosses is perfect for that. For those of you who are familiar with it, it's just one shape, the elongated hexagon with some squares. And the squares are just used to join the blocks together. So this, in talking about simplicity and about, first I'll show you some of the blocks here. Here's an example of the start of a Lucy Boston block with just four hexagons in the middle and four hexagons coming out. These are 90-degree hexagons. This is a 90-degree angle. You're more familiar with grandmother's flower garden, perhaps. Those have 60-degree angles and six sides. This has a 90-degree angle at the two ends. So this shape was used quite a bit by Lucy Boston, and I love it too. You can see how beautifully it presses on the back. Now, when I wrote the book in 2008, 2009, I contacted Diana Boston at Lucy Boston's manor in near Cambridge in England, and she was so gracious and so welcoming about the idea of doing a book about Lucy Boston's most famous quote. I couldn't have done it without her. She put me in touch with Julia Hedgeco, who did all of the photography so that I could use it in the book. So that was in 2009 that the book was actually published, and now we're still reprinting it 9 years later. So that just shows the staying power of Lucy Boston. Now, one of the reasons that I chose to even consider the Patchwork of the Crosses for Inklingo was that Inklingo makes it so much easier than the method that Lucy Boston used. Now, you have to remember here that Lucy Boston was sewing in the late 50s, early 60s when she made Patchwork of the Crosses. She never had a quilting class. I can show you what her main quilt book looked like. This is what I couldn't resist buying a copy of this. This is what quilt books looked like in the 1950s and 1960s. All black and white with one little section of photos, also in black and white. Can you imagine? Are we spoiled today with all of the books and things that we have? And that to me makes it even more amazing that Lucy Boston accomplished what she did. She didn't have the selection of fabric that we have today. She didn't have classes and all kinds of groups around her, other people who were quilting. She did this out of thin air. She was basically an artist, and she was able to look at fabric and see how it could be used to create new designs. I can see more of you have joined in. I'm just going to glance over here to look at the feed. Okay, Pamela in High Point, North Carolina. Hello. Gay has joined again. Hi, Gay. Gay is in Michigan. Oh, Donna says she loves Patchwork of the Crosses. And, you know, a lot of you I know, if you're familiar with Inklingo, if you just haven't, you know, stumbled on this video, you probably have seen a lot of Patchwork of the Crosses blocks, maybe on Pinterest or on Instagram or on my website or in videos. I have a video, a couple of videos about Patchwork of the Crosses. But if you're not familiar with Lucy Boston, she is just a huge inspiration. And one of the things that's kind of cool to know about her is that although she did make 20 patchworks or 22, she was actually more famous as a gardener. Her garden is still maintained by Diana Boston. In England. It's called Hemmingford Gray. And I hope, actually, when I post this on the blog for the replay, I will put in a link to Hemmingford Gray. It's a nice website. You can buy Lucy Boston's children's books, which some of you may be familiar with. That's actually what she's the most famous for, is the children's books. And there's information on my site about a movie that was made, an adaptation of one of the books. And there, even on Diana's Hemmingford Gray website, you can buy a DVD that gives you a little tour of the house and the gardens. And the house is a very old Norman manor that Lucy Boston restored. Anyway, that's kind of what I wanted to talk about today. That's a little bit of introduction about Lucy Boston, but for anybody who isn't familiar with her at all. But I was really excited about it, especially this week, because I thought it was appropriate since the reprint of the book had been delivered, and because I really wanted to have a simple live video this time. So I'm going to switch cameras again to show you this. Let's see here. There we go. Now I'm not on camera. I can look wherever I want. This is a basket here, sort of a flat basket. I bought this because in the photographs of Lucy Boston's house, you can see that she used flat round baskets like this to organize her sewing. And she would have kept her ongoing projects in it, maybe some blocks that she had in progress, just like I do, and scissors and needle, maybe a pin cushion, some thread, you know, very simple supplies. And she would have also had Basildon Bond writing paper, which she used to make her templates. You have to remember that this was in the 1950s and 1960s. Freezer paper was not around for quilters at that time. I am sure that Lucy Boston would have loved to have used freezer paper if it had been available. And of course, nowadays we have every advantage that we can use freezer paper. We have, you know, the best selection of fabric that's ever been available. Oh, I'm looking at the wrong camera again. Sorry about that. Let's see. Did Donna tell me that? No. I'm looking here now because I know I'm on this camera. Okay. I'm getting little reminders here where to look. But Lucy Boston didn't have the selection of fabric that we have. In fact, she would go into London or into any quilt shop anywhere basically twice a year and buy as much fabric as she thought she could use. And then she was stuck with what she had. Now, the reason I know this is that Diana Boston, who was married to Lucy Boston's only child, her son, wrote a book about Lucy Boston's quilts. This is not a pattern book, but it is the book that I first saw that alerted me to the idea that Lucy Boston was even out there. It's a gorgeous book with photographs. Mine is autographed by Diana, by the way, my own personal copy. But for each quilt, there is a full-size photo and some close-ups, and it describes how the, I'll show you the one for Patchwork of the Crosses. Here, there's a one close-up in the book, and oh, there's the other one, another close-up of just a single block. And now, as I say, this book does not include patterns and instructions. It does give information about each of the quilts, but they're actually coverlets. There is no inner layer. There's just a lining and the front. And Lucy Boston made all of these with English paper piecing. And I knew from the minute I saw the quilt that that would be by far the hardest way, the slowest way, the least precise way to make it. But that was the method that Lucy Boston knew. That was the method in England in the 1950s and 1960s. So that is what she used. But my eye, from an Inklingo point of view, looking at Patchwork of the Crosses, said, wow, this is perfect. This would be so much easier. I could even sew this by machine if I had the lines printed on the fabric with Inklingo. So that was what instigated the call to Diana. Now, I've got some, maybe I'll go back to this camera, a little close-up camera, so it's showing how the shapes look printed on the fabric. Can you see the lines there? This is one of the things I wanted to simplify this time was this camera that I'm showing these on right now kept going out of focus in live videos 1, 2, and 3, and I found it totally aggravating. I've talked to a computer guru, and he has told me that there is a way that I can use higher quality cameras than the webcams that I've been trying to use. Theoretically, this camera is supposed to focus this close, and it did. It did actually focus this close, but it kept going out of focus. Like even if I just move my hand in here, I think you can see it's in focus, then it's out of focus. It drove me crazy. So that's why I'm not actually sewing this time, because I really think that Charles is going to be able to set me up so that I will actually be able to stitch, to rotary cut, to do all kinds of things. With a better camera than the one here that was going out of focus. So let me see who's joined us. Oh, here we've got lots of Patchwork of the Crosses. Now here's an example. Della has written Patchwork of the Crosses. She's not familiar with it. So Della, this is your introduction. It's the quilt in this book. That's one thing we have to keep in mind with these live videos. You don't know when someone is tuning in. But this is a book I wrote in 2009. You'll be able to watch the replay of this video to get a little bit more background on it. But I thought some people might be tuning in who aren't familiar with it. So I'm glad you mentioned that, Della. There will be, when I put the replay on the blog, there will be lots of links so that you can see more detail and know where to go. Now I can see there are tons more comments. How do I move? Oh, here. I just need to scroll. Janice in Kentucky, Cheryl in Washington State. This is super. Thank you for joining in. Barb Clark says hi to Russ. He just laughed, Barb. He's not on camera tonight. let's see. Who else have we got? Okay. Well, thank you for leaving the comments here. I love knowing that I'm not just talking to an empty camera, that somebody's really listening. So as I said, I wanted to make this simpler. I didn't want to be relying on a camera that was going to go out of focus. I didn't want to, make it more complicated than it is, because this is actually hard. trying to coordinate things with three cameras, the screen and video feed coming in and the Facebook feed going out. So there's the Lucy Boston basket. Now, what struck me was how simple her tools were. Basically, paper templates. She thread basted the fabric to the paper templates for English paper piecing. She had a needle and thread and a very limited supply of fabric. It's absolutely tragic that she didn't have access to more great materials. Anyway, she actually, one thing that I can't agree with Lucy Boston, is that in Diana's book, she explains that Diana Boston would use the same needle and put a curve in it. She liked it when the needle got so worn that it was bent, and she would use it for as long as she possibly could, I suppose until it was lost. Now, I, on the other hand, believe in replacing your needle very often. It really makes a difference. It makes everything more pleasurable. The needle slides through the fabric more easily. But again, Lucy Boston didn't have access to the needles and fabric and freezer paper and Inklingo that we have. But on the other hand, our tools are very simple too. I do not use a flat basket like this, but I'd like to show you what I do like. I've tested just to see how it, can you see this? This looks kind of like a briefcase, and it has legs. There. And a lid. And I'll show you what I put inside. I can lay out, can you see? A block. There are slots here on the sides for my needle and thread and scissors. I've lined the center compartment with Minky so that everything stays in place. Isn't that cool? Now, if you haven't seen these before, they're called Smart Lap Portable Desks, and they're for kids. But you don't have to show ID or anything. If you feel better, you can say you're buying it for a kid. I love this thing. It makes everything very neat and organized and easy to keep track of. I can have whatever I want packed up in this. And basically, what I want is what Lucy Boston wanted in her basket. I want fabric ready to sew. I want needle and thread and scissors, my reading glasses, and I'm good to go. So anyway, I wanted to show you that. It's a neat thing. And actually, with the replay as well, I will share a link. You can go buy these on Amazon. Not in Canada, but the U.S. Amazon site has them on for $20. So I have no affiliation with these people. I just think it's a really cool product. And if you're sewing on the go, no matter what method you enjoy, whether you're using English paper piecing or sewing with a running stitch or, you know, some combination of the two, it's a neat way to carry your stuff around. So I'm going to have a look again to see who's joined us. Let's see here. North Carolina. Yeah, you are right, Zan. You're doing it with cardstock. This is a lot easier. Actually, I'll show you a few of the blocks so that you can see the front and the back. As I said, I'm not going to actually do any stitching because I found it really frustrating to see everything going out of focus. But here I've changed cameras again. You can see on the back, this is just sewn with a running stitch. That's basically two loads of the needle. Turn the corner, finish the other two. It goes really, really fast. You can sew probably four of these, eight hexagons, in the time it would take you just to baste and prep and sew one with English paper piecing. This goes really fast. It makes a very strong seam, and it allows you to press. Oh, I know I just went out of focus there. I hate that. There, I've put it down. Let's see. Okay, you can see the seams are pressed to the side. It's a very strong seam when it's sewn with a running stitch like this. And I'm getting distracted now by the out of focus. I really hate that. But here, if you're in focus now, you can see the way I've pressed it to go around that intersection. It presses to be open, makes it perfect on the front. And once that seam is pressed that way, I can go around all of the others. It all presses perfectly. And actually, maybe I'll switch, get off this out of focus camera now and go back and show you a variation I made. This one is a smaller version of Patchwork of the Crosses. You can see I didn't do the full-size block. The full-size block without the connectors is like this. Okay. These are a ring short, but I use Lucy Boston's fussy cutting with Inklingo No Waste fussy cutting. And this is, I love this thing. This is with fussy cutting with Inklingo. There are two methods. And we've talked about this in the first Inklingo live videos too. There are more videos on the website. There's more on the blog. But basically, you can either use templates for fussy cutting, or you can print identical sheets of fabric to get sets of identical shapes. That depends on having a great fabric like this. But isn't this pretty? Very simple. It's simpler than the whole Lucy Boston Patchwork of the Crosses quilt, but it gives a great effect. And I want to show you the back, just how pretty the back is. Can you see how that little bit of pressing that I showed you is consistent all the way across this? So, okay, there we go. That's okay, so let's see what we have here. There, I can see Facebook has this time lag, which it confuses me, so I'm trying not to glance over there. But I can see, oh good, who else has joined in from Kentucky? From Ohio, hi Sherry. And Sharon Pratt says she has her quilt about half finished. Perfect. Karen in New Mexico. Oh, thank you for joining in, everybody. This is great. I am going to go through all of your comments afterwards. I love seeing where everybody is from. And if you have questions, I will either answer you on Facebook or by email. You can also email me. My email address is on the screen right now, linda@lindafranz.com. I always answer. If you don't get an answer, it means I didn't get your email. And certainly if it's a question where I can sense you need a really fast answer, I answer as quickly as possible. So let's see here. I've got a few things. So I wanted to talk about keeping it simple. Let's see. I made a few notes. They're just a mess. Okay, the focus problem. Now, this is something that apparently can be fixed. I have better cameras than these little webcams, and maybe I didn't want to do a whole thing on fussy cutting this time. I want that one to be perfect. I want to be able to keep everything in focus. So that will be a more complicated live video later once we get the cameras perfected. On this theme of simplicity that I have for tonight, one of the things that I think we have a huge advantage nowadays, because we have freezer paper. As I said, Lucy Boston didn't have that advantage. We do. And even quilters in very remote areas in all of the 65 or more countries where Inklingo is used, people can get freezer paper somehow. And as you know, freezer paper is a paper with a one side papery, and on the back there's a very thin plastic coating. That plastic coating will bond temporarily to fabric when it's pressed with a hot iron. So even quilters in Peru and New Zealand and South Africa and, you know, little tiny countries in Europe, everywhere, people can get freezer paper somewhere. A lot of Australians will buy it from quilt shops. In Canada and the United States, we can get it in regular grocery stores. It's just cheap and readily available. You use everything over and over again. So because we have freezer paper, any quilter only ever needs, in my opinion, three acrylic rulers. I like to have two of these. This is a basically 6 by 20 by 24, or 6.5 by 24 inch. I have two of those because they're really handy for cutting big sheets of freezer paper into the size that we actually use to go through the printer. I have a 3 by 18 that I love. It's actually 3.5 by 18.5. And I have a 1 by 12. And that's all the acrylic that I think anybody needs. I think acrylic templates are make life harder. Not only are they expensive, easy to lose, slip around on the surface of fabric, although there are ways to try to hold them in place, they don't have any of the advantages of freezer paper. So let me show you what I mean. No matter what shape I want, if I have the shape without seam allowances, I can plunk it down on fabric, iron it in position, or just hold it in position. The plastic coating actually wants to stay in place on the fabric, even if you don't press. And then use any acrylic ruler to add the quarter inch seam allowance when you cut. This means if I'm cutting this little kite shape for a Silent Garden, another quilt that uses fussy cutting, I do not need this shape in acrylic. In fact, if someone gave me one, I wouldn't use it because the freezer paper gives me more advantages. When I use a freezer paper template with no seam allowances, I can then here, I'll just show you. Here, on my Silent Garden, if you watched live video number 3, you know I changed my mind on the setting. And I tore out all of these little diamonds. So I'm going to show you here. Hopefully this will stay in focus. If I want to take this diamond and instead use it as a kite, I want the plastic side down. I could hit this with an iron and hold it in place, or I can just cut and add the quarter inch seam allowance, and I can use a little ruler and a pencil and mark the whole seam line. If I was using an acrylic template, the best I would have would be a little hole at the intersections to try to mark a dot. I think it's much easier to have a line on the whole length of the... So for any shape, and actually I hear from quilters fairly often who will, you know, they'll be making some sort of quilt that they've seen online or in a magazine, and they say, you know, I have all of the shapes for Inklingo, I can print them, but there isn't this one shape, this kite or this size of triangle or something else that they don't have or that isn't available from Inklingo. And the thing is that within minutes, you don't need an acrylic template. You don't absolutely have to print with Inklingo. You can draw whatever you want on freezer paper in the finished size and add the seam allowance when you rotary cut. Now, I've written about this several times on the blog. Because I know a lot, I hear from quilters all the time who have bought Patchwork of the Crosses, the book, and they think they need an acrylic template, even though I don't recommend acrylic templates in the book. And people do sell acrylic templates for it, but as I say, I don't think they have any advantage over either drawing or printing the shapes on freezer paper and adding the seam allowance when you rotary cut. So this, if you're tuned into this live video, that is one really great tip. And it doesn't make any difference whether you're using Inklingo or not. Even if you never print on fabric, even if you never intend to learn how to use Inklingo, using freezer paper templates it can set you free. You can have a line to draw on. You have to draw it manually instead of printing it, but you don't need to be held hostage by waiting for templates to be made or templates to be shipped, or just feeling that you can't make something in a size you want because that template isn't available. So that's your tip, whether you're using Inklingo or not. And freezer paper templates, I really feel freezer paper is a much better tool than using acrylic anytime. But it has huge advantages when you're fussy cutting. Now, I like Inklingo No Waste Fussy Cutting, which I've written about many times and which we'll do a video on. This is the one where you have a fabric with a busy design where you print identical sheets of fabric. Now, that depends on choosing the right kind of fabric, just like it does for Stack and Whack or One Block Wonder. Obviously, they don't work. Those designs don't work well with very plain fabrics with a lot of blank space. But if you don't have a fabric like that and you want to fussy cut individual designs, a freezer paper template is again better than having an acrylic template. So here, I'll just give you an idea. Here I've got this fabric. Now this one is good for Inklingo No Waste Fussy Cutting, but I can also use templates with it. If I want to just pick out a particular design that I would like to cut 4 or 8 of, and I would iron this window template on first. When I have it and all of the other 7 or 8 or 10, however many I need, in position, and I know I have enough of them that will all be identical, I will pop the center in, iron it in place, and peel off the window that got me started. So that's just a little teaser on the fussy cutting with templates. Again, you don't need an acrylic template. In fact, it's not an advantage because you can't draw the sewing lines. So, okay, that's one of my favorite tips. And again, very simple. If you have freezer paper and 3 sizes of acrylic ruler, that's all the acrylic you need. And that means you don't have to buy racks for your acrylic. You don't have to worry if acrylic rulers are getting lost or broken or just the expense of them. I would rather spend $20 on fabric than $20 on another ruler. Maybe you're different. That's just me. But I really think those are good tips. And it simplifies the whole process, because using freezer paper templates applies whether you're doing applique, whether you're machine piecing, or whether you're hand piecing. It's not something different every time. So again, that kind of goes with my simple theme. So I'm looking at the wrong camera now. I'm looking over at Facebook. Let's see who's joined us. Hi, Orly, thanks for joining us again. You've been here before. Jean says she hasn't been able to get her dad's inkjet printer to cooperate with fabric yet. That is a shame, Jean, but I am glad you wrote, because there are some simple tricks. Again, simplicity is my middle name here, that make it almost foolproof, where you should not get jams. The most important things I can say are you must wash the fabric first to get out all that sizing. so that the freezer paper will stick well, and you must use a hot, dry iron to get a good bond. I think most jams happen when the freezer paper separates from the fabric in the printer and then it gets scrunched up. That doesn't need to happen. There are a few simple tips, and there are articles about this on the blog. For example, I really like my Canon printer. I cannot remember the last time I had a jam. I have no affiliation. I just love the way it prints. I love the ease of setting the custom sizes that we use, but the Canon printer seems to like me to leave the leading edge, the first, let's see, maybe I've got one of my samples shows it. Yes, here, you can see if I leave just a narrow strip of freezer paper showing on the leading edge, it just grabs it perfectly, feeds it through perfectly, and I put in stacks at a time, and as I say, it's been months and months since I had a jam. But make sure the fabric has been washed, make sure it has adhered well to the freezer paper. Now, when I say adhered well, it should still peel off easily, and the freezer paper can be used over and over and over and over again. So, you know, it's not, you shouldn't be having a hard time getting the fabric off, but it should be really adhered so that it doesn't jam in the printer. Anyway, if you want to write to me, let's see, I'll send you a link on Facebook afterwards. I am sorry you've had a jam, but I think if I send you the links to more information, that'll be a thing of the past and you'll feel really confident that you can do this. Okay, we've got a few people here who are, oh, nice. I'm seeing all kinds of familiar names. I don't know how to pronounce everybody's name. We have Suli. S-U-E-L-Y. I'm afraid I'm pronouncing that wrong, Suli. And Orly, I think I've got right. Now, Beata, is that right? B-E-A-T-E. I know, I recognize your name, and I love it that you're watching either from either of your usual locations. You'll have to email me and tell me how I should pronounce your name. And Lydia from either Portugal or Brazil. Now that, am I saying that wrong? I'm certainly saying it with a Canadian accent. I have had so much feedback about how I mispronounce the names of the quilts in Mille Fiori quilts 1, 2, and 3. It's almost become a trademark. It's so embarrassing. Anyway, you'll have to bear with my Canadian interpretation. Okay, Joanne has asked a good question. Linda, do you iron the template to the right side or the wrong side of the fabric? Now that is a great question because, as you know, for printing on fabric with Inklingo, we iron the freezer paper to the right side of the fabric so that we can print on the wrong side. But when we're putting an individual template, here, I'll go back to this other out of focus camera. When we want to use a template like this, we do it on the wrong side so that we can draw the lines on the wrong side of the fabric. Okay, so that was a really good question. And actually, in the very early days of Inklingo, when this would be, you know, 2006, when just a few people like Mary and Kathy and a couple of Kathys and Tilda and a few others were starting out with Inklingo, we had all been doing Quilted Diamonds and Dear Jane together. And when we switched to Inklingo, we would inadvertently iron the freezer paper to the wrong side of the fabric, because that is what we had been doing for years. And we had to make the switch when we went to Inklingo to always iron the freezer paper onto the right side of the fabric. By the way, that's another point for Joanne's question, which is a great question, Joanne. When I'm fussy cutting and using the window template that I mentioned, like this, I will try, because I want to draw the lines on the fabric, I will try to do the fussy cutting from the wrong side. If I can't, I'll do the cutting and get the shape cut out from the right side of the fabric, and then position the template on the wrong side just for when I want to draw the pencil lines to show the sewing lines and the crosshairs for the seam endings. So that's, how am I doing for looking at this camera? Hey, I'm very conscious of this tonight. I'm sure I'm coming up with new mistakes somehow. I think my other camera just went out of focus. Focus is driving me mad. Anyway, it's each video I've done, from video number one to video number two. Video number one had some audio problems. I think I fixed them in video number two, but then we created new, different audio problems. There was another audio problem in the third live video. This time I'm using completely different microphones and a completely different setup. And as I said, I'm trying to keep it simpler so that we're not having focus issues and so that we're not going out of focus. So where were my notes here? What else did I want to? So I've told you why I want to keep it simple, that we only ever need three sizes of rulers at the most, as far as I can see. You can use freezer paper templates for any shape. You don't need to buy acrylic. Lucy Boston's tools and the old book. Okay, I will provide links with the replay showing now, oh my goodness, it's already a quarter to seven? A quarter to eight? I can't believe it. Of course, that's Saturday morning in Australia and very late at night in the EU and just before dinner in California. But here, it's getting on to 8 o'clock. There was one other thing I wanted to do. As I said, I didn't want to have a camera going out of focus when I was trying to sew. But after the last two videos, I got quite a few comments from people who were stunned that they could use Inklingo to print shapes on fabric for machine piecing. And of course, it's ideal for machine piecing. I was a hand piecer, or my first two books were on hand piecing, the Quilted Diamonds books. But of course I do machine piecing, and of course machine piecers like having a line too. So do quilters who do applique. So I thought, instead of actually sewing live with a camera that might go out of focus, I decided that what I would do this time is show you a very short video with some machine piecing. And I'm going to go to that screen now. And I'm not going to talk because the video has its own soundtrack. And we'll just see how this works. This is a test.
I'm making flying geese for Bonnie Hunter's Easy Street Mystery. I need to make 64 flying geese with my turquoise and purple scraps. Bonnie always lets us know the finish size, in this case, 1.5 by 3 inches, and that's all I need to know to use Inklingo, because all Inklingo shapes are named with the finish size. Thanks to Bonnie's instructions, I know I need 1.5-inch half-square triangles. Thanks to Inklingo's instructions, I know I only have to print the half-square triangles. I cut squares from my purple scraps without printing. I will get 4 geese units from each 4.25-inch square, so only 16 squares will give me all 64. If I wanted to, I could print the squares, but this size is easy to measure, so I rotary cut. I need 2 triangles for each flying geese unit, so for 64, I need 128 triangles. I could just print 4 sheets of fabric to get 128 triangles, but I want more variety, so I printed more fabrics. My geese will look really scrappy. I iron the freezer paper to the right side of the fabric and trim around it at the ironing board. I have tested the ink in my printer, and I know all 20 Inklingo colors wash out, so I felt safe printing darker than usual for the sake of the camera. The printing goes fast, even when I printed 7 pages. Once the triangles are printed, I can remove the freezer paper and use it over and over again. I rotary cut the triangles into rows, stack the rows, and then cut into squares. I could cut on the lines with scissors if I wanted. I do not cut the individual triangles apart for this method, but I like to trim the dog ears off one corner of a stack before I start sewing. I print the 1-page sewing and pressing guide from the Triangle Tips PDF as a reference beside the sewing machine. I sew 2 turquoise squares to each purple square. That's 2 seams 16 times. I don't need to pin, and the bias is stable because it has not been cut yet. I am careful to sew a scant 1/4-inch seam allowance, which means sewing immediately beside the line, not on it. I use scissors or a rotary cutter to separate the 2 halves and press. I added squares of different fabrics for the next step for lots of variety. Sew 2 seams on each of 32 units. Then cut and press. Voila! 64 flying geese. There is lots of variety. Even with only 6 different turquoise fabrics, I only got a few duplicate geese. That's it. Print, sew, and cut. There is no waste and no need to trim at the end. My best tip is to sew 1 set of 4 and measure to be sure you are sewing an accurate, scant 1/4-inch seam allowance. Every one should be a perfect 2 by 3.5 unfinished. I love the Inklingo method because it is so fast and the results are perfect, without special rulers with confusing instructions, without any math, and without cutting individual triangles. There is also no wasted fabric and no squaring up or trimming at the end. That is a dangerous extra step. It is much easier to get perfect results when there are no stretchy bias seams to sew and no need to manually draw lines on fabric. Please check out the other videos on YouTube and see the top 10 toots on the All About Inklingo blog. Be sure to download the free Triangle Tips PDF under the Machine Piecing tab on the Inklingo website. There is also a free shape collection in the shop, so you can try this technique for flying geese in another size right now. Monkey has added his favorite links in the text below the video screen. If you enjoyed this video, please like it and tell your friends. Thank you for watching.
Okay, that was, I hope, a good test. What I wanted to do there is, as I said, it's really frustrated me that I have these great cameras that will focus very close up, But these little webcams are not staying in focus when I'm sewing. So assuming that that little test of that pre-recorded video for flying geese worked as well as I think it did, I will be able, and until I can get the whole camera situation sorted out, I can use my good cameras to pre-record things that I want to share with you on the live video. So I think that might be a good test, something that I'm really anxious to see the replay of this to make sure that it turned out as well as I think it did. So we're almost at the end of an hour. I thought we would be shorter this time, but we've covered my list. I really want to emphasize what I was talking about tonight was, well, the excitement of getting the new reprint of Patchwork of the Crosses, my love affair with Lucy Boston and sewing these gorgeous blocks. I have so many more of them here that I was going to show. I should have shown these earlier too. But the idea that she used simple tools, we can use simple tools, but we have the advantages of freezer paper templates, of acrylic rulers and rotary cutting, which of course Lucy Boston didn't have. And we can either use a nice flat basket like she had, or we can use a portable lap desk meant for kids. So whatever method we use, the point is that we're being creative. We're creating an heirloom, just the way Lucy Boston did. We're expressing ourselves, and we've got a community of quilters that we can do it with. So I hope you will subscribe to the blog. If you're following on Inklingo, thank you. I wrote to the Yahoo group, the Inklingo Yahoo group today, explaining that when I made the announcement about this live video coming on tonight, 48 hours passed before it was even shown to 149 of the 44,700 people who have said they like Inklingo on Facebook. So unless, if you're on Facebook and you're not seeing feeds from people that you want to see them from, whether it's from me at Inklingo or other quilters or businesses where you thought because you liked their page that you would see what those people were posting, and you're not seeing it, what you have to do is go back to those pages and choose to follow. Facebook is trying to limit the number of people who see what I post on the Inklingo Facebook page, and that is their way of trying to force me to pay them to distribute my photos and videos and other information that I post on the Inklingo page to the people who have said they like Inklingo. So I hope you, and the other thing, if you don't want to actually follow, you should check the Inklingo page and any of the other pages that you've liked for other businesses periodically, because Facebook is not putting this stuff in your timeline, and you might be amazed at what you've missed if you go back and look at the Facebook page that you thought you were following. So, it's a good idea to subscribe to the blog. That way you do get an email to alert you when there's going to be another live video or something else going on. And something like a reprint of Patchwork of the Crosses. Really, it's thanks to quilters like you that that's all possible. So we're almost at an hour. I really thank you for joining me. It went very fast for me. If you missed part of this or want to review it, I'll try to get it up with a replay and some good links on Sunday. Not tomorrow. Tomorrow's Saturday. But on Sunday, Canada time, I will have this available for you so that you can go back and watch part of it if you like. In the meantime, let's keep things simple. And at some point, I'll be back with live video number 5. Thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.